understand that your theme is loving God. Well, I'm not, this is not my sermon. I got something else for that. But as I was looking at that and the Lord was showing me, that it's an awesome theme for God to love us the way he does. It's awesome for us to love God. But look how he loves us. You don't have to turn if you don't want to. But in Psalms 86 and 5, this is in the NLT version, it says, "Oh Lord, you are so good, so ready to forgive, so full of unfailing love for all that ask for your help." Woo! Now it's awesome that loving God from our perspective is something. But think about how he loves us unconditionally. He didn't ask for anything from us, and he loves us anyway. Psalms 86 and 15 says, "But you, O Lord, are a God of compassion and mercy and slow to anger and filled with unfailing love and faithfulness." So when you think of your theme, loving God, and how you should love God, think about how he loves you. Think about how he loves you, and he loves you unconditionally. So to God be the glory. God has given me a word for this house. I prayed and I asked him, and he's just so awesome. And he started speaking to me about his word. His word. And I said, "Well, what do you mean, Lord?" He said, "Everything in my word." He said, "I have to honor that." So my topic today is, he stepped out of heaven to honor his word. He stepped out of heaven to honor his word. And the reason he stepped out of heaven is because while he was up there in heaven, Jesus was sitting right next to the Father, and the Holy Ghost was hovering over the heaven that we know to be where God resides. But guess what? The Lord looked down and saw that we needed help to make sure that his word would be fulfilled and we'd be able to be a part of his word. So what God decided to do was, he said, now this is, you can turn to it, John 1 and 14. John 1 and 14, I'm reading from the NLT. I love the King James, but the NLT makes it a little easier on the reading and the understanding. John 1 and 14 says, "So the word became human and made his home among us. He was full of unfailing love and faithfulness, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the Father's one and only Son." Now, when God showed me the word, I said, "Well, Lord, what are you saying to me?" His word, what does his word say? His word says, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God." First. And after you seek me, then you'll find and get all that you need. He said, if you wait on the Lord and be of good courage, I'll strengthen your heart. So I'm listening to all the words he's talking to me. He said, in the beginning was the word, and the word was God, and the word was with God. Okay, so now you're talking all about your word. Then he began to show me in his word, we must become desperate for Jesus. How many people in here know in this season it's the time to become desperate for the Lord? Because time is winding up. We've heard for years and years and years and decades that Jesus is soon to come back. We're closer now than we've ever been before. The Bible says these signs will follow them that believe. Are we all believers in here? Do we all see the signs that's happening in the world? This is a season. We have to become desperate for him. And when he stepped there, God is so awesome. When he stepped out of heaven to honor his word, guess what? He surrendered his glory. He surrendered his glory. And when he surrendered his glory, he allowed us to be partakers of the glory. I'm going to talk about that later. We ought to all be glory carriers. And when you're a glory carrier, what happens is when you hit any atmosphere, you change it. You don't have to do nothing. Just make sure that all that you have is all that God has allowed you to get from him. Now, when we become desperate for Jesus, based on what is most precious to us through sacrifice, that's how we become desperate for Jesus. Is based on what's most precious to us as sacrifice. Nobody likes to give up anything. Nobody likes to sacrifice. And when God told me, he said, when I stepped out of heaven to honor my word, not only did I surrender my glory, he said, but he ransomed us from sin. He ransomed us from sin. He redeemed us from the curse of the law and became the curse of the law on our behalf. He became the curse of the law on our behalf. Now, when you become desperate for him, he said, I set up a process. When I stepped out of heaven for you, I set up a process for you to follow. The first step is you say yes to salvation. What does that mean? When the Holy Spirit, when God himself starts tugging, we've all been in the world doing what we do, doing what we did. That's what it was. But at some point, God will allow you to go for a long time doing what you want, when you want, how you want. But at some point, there becomes a fork in the road. And that fork in the road, he starts to tugging on you. He starts to pulling on your heartstrings. He starts to pulling and talking to your mind. And you keep pulling the other direction. But while God is doing all of that, he's setting you up. Because now he's calling you unto him. So the first step is salvation. After you get that tugging and pulling and you go to church and you get overwhelmed and you go up and say yes, yes, yes. Now you're not even sure what you're saying yes to, but the Holy Ghost done got a hold to you and you don't even realize it. And you go running up there and yes, Lord, yes, yes. Okay, that's step one. You're not there yet. Praise the Lord. After step one with salvation, just saying yes, this next step is sanctification. Sanctification does not mean that we have to be holier than thou. It simply means that you have a made up mind to be set apart for the use of Jesus Christ. Now, after sanctification, this is the tough one. It's the one right in the middle. Sacrifice. Sacrifice. Nobody ever wants to sacrifice. And let me tell you something. God wants us to sacrifice voluntarily. But how many know you can, God will allow you to sacrifice involuntarily? You don't have to volunteer to sacrifice certain things. This is as a witness of myself. I can remember when my son passed away. He didn't pass away right away. He was in a terrible car accident, my very firstborn. And for 6 long months, God kept him. And I was newly saved. And I believed with all my heart God was going to raise him up. But then the Lord took him home. And he said to me, sacrifice, daughter. I sacrificed my son. That you might know me. Now you must sacrifice your son that the generational curses that live in your family are broken. Let me tell you something. Living for Jesus, it looked like, I like to look dressed up. Praise the Lord, that's me. But Sister Hodge been through some stuff. Oh, glory to God. It's okay to get dressed up but still know who dressed you. Understand that? I know who dressed me. I know who dressed me. And you can't just look good. You got to have the goods. And that's Jesus. That's Jesus. And you, when you are a glory carrier, Jesus will automatically illuminate. You don't have to do nothing but be faithful unto him. Sacrifice. What do we say? Salvation, sanctification. We right in the middle road now. Sacrifice. What does it mean to sacrifice? What does it mean? It means to give up something that is not easy to give up. It means put your flesh under subjection. Because what happens is every one of us are flesh. Nothing but dust and going back to dust. And we have the will, if we choose to continue to feed our flesh and give it what it wants. And we always try to justify, even in our saved, sanctified, Holy Ghost-filled selves, we try to justify that it's okay if I decide I don't feel like reading tonight. I don't feel like talking to the Lord tonight. I want to do this. I want to do that. And the Lord said, that's not a sacrifice. A sacrifice is when you give something up that hurts you and that puts your flesh under subjection. After sacrifice, now God said, you're ready to serve for me. Now it's time for servitude from God. You're going to be a servant of the Most High God. After you serve, there is something called success. We ain't talking about the world's success. The world thinks success is one thing when you have a wonderful career or job and lots of money and all of those wonderful tangible things. But the road to success for Jesus is when you've hit all four of those particular processes, and now you're on the road that serves purpose and destiny just for Jesus. Now, what do we talk about? Salvation, sanctification, sacrifice, which is the most difficult, service, and then success. If nothing else, remember that is the process God set up for you when he stepped outside of his comfort zone. And see, if Jesus stepped outside of his comfort zone, he stepped outside of heaven to honor his word. His word had to be honored. And the only way he could do it was by stepping outside of that. And so what God began to show me about, he'd start talking to me about Jeremiah. And you know, what does it mean to become desperate? How many know what it is when you're desperate for something? When you're really desperate for it? I know, you know, men and women, when they first meet and they fall in love and they become desperate for one another's love and affection, it fades, but God is still an awesome God. So what about when you become desperate for Jesus? What does it mean to become desperate? It means having a great need or desire for something. We ought to have a great need and desire for God right now because of the way the world is. He started talking to me about Jeremiah. And this is why he said I had to step outside of heaven to honor my word and surrender my glory. He said because when I told Jeremiah in Jeremiah 1:5, this is the King James Version. It's a well-memorized scripture, but this is the what Jeremiah talked about. He said, I knew you before you were formed, before you were born. I sanctified and ordained you as a prophet. So he stepped outside of heaven to honor that word, but then he said, I took it further. Ah, how many know the word of God says a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is like a day. God didn't create time for himself. He created time for us, but He came outside of time to validate his authority. He came outside of time to validate his authority. And what he did was, while we are talking about Jeremiah, and he knew him before he was formed, he knew him before he was born, and he predestined and ordained him as a prophet. He knew each and every one of you before you were born. He predestined and ordained everything that's going to happen in your life. Even the wrong choices we make, even the wrong paths we take, it's okay, because God is already, it's not an afterthought. It's not like he's sitting up there thinking, oh, I think now I'm going to let Pastor Murphy be the pastor of this church. God had already predestined and ordained it. Didn't matter what it looked like. It didn't matter what nobody else said or thought. It was already written, and it was already with God's stamp of approval on it. So when God does that, if he did it for Jeremiah, he did it for Pastor Murphy, he will do it for each and every one of you. Whatever the will of God is for your life, he's already put his stamp of approval on it. All you have to do is remember, he stepped out of heaven to honor that word. Ooh, glory to God. Glory to God. He also told Jeremiah 29:11. He said, the plans that I have for you are not to bring you to a disastrous place. He said, but to give you a future and a hope. If God wants to give you a future and a hope, who in the world could stop God? Who in the world could stop God? Who can't nobody stop him? He's God all by himself. It's already done. So whatever your dilemma might be right now that you can see in the natural, know that God has already put his stamp of approval in the spiritual realm on it. And it's already done. A lot of us don't know what we're supposed to do. But God said, if you stay in my word, make sure you commune with me in relationship. I had someone tell me, well, you know, I was talking to God and he didn't answer me. God doesn't have to answer us. He's God. He didn't have to answer us. All we have to do is commune with him. And when we don't hear him, sometimes it's because we're not in the right place to hear what he has to tell us. So we're not ready to receive it. And he knows that, because he knows the beginning from the beginning to the end. And everything in between, God is very familiar with it. And I've been wondering why for years now the churches have been diminishing. The miracles haven't been taking place like years ago when I got saved. And I said, what is it, God? What is going on? True, we're in a different time right now, but God didn't change. He said, I'm the same. He said, because the people have forgot to put me as their first priority. Even those in the church. And sometimes we can get so used to and accustomed to doing something that we get caught up in where we're at and forgot where we came from and who's in charge. God is in complete control, complete charge. Sometimes the arena starts to look a little cloudy with politics. God is not pleased. And when the Lord said to me he wasn't pleased, he's not talking about the world. He said, because the world don't know me. He said, it's my bride. It's my bride. It's my bride. It's my bride. It's the church. But because he loves us so much, we saw how much he loved us, and he loves us in his word. And we know the scripture that said he loved us so much he gave his only begotten son. And see, Jesus, God gave his only begotten son, and he allowed, God sacrificed his precious son. And then his precious son went to the cross and sacrificed his precious blood for each and every one of us. I'm looking for miracles. And I said, what is it going to take, God? I'm talking about real miracles. Miracles like they had back in the day. Woo, glory, glory, glory. Real miracles. And you know what it's based on? Unifying together as one. That's what it. How can two come together unless they agree? Unless they agree. And God is the author of agreement. He's the author of agreement. And see, when two of God's vessels, just two, he said one could put 1,000 to flight, two could put 10,000 to flight. If you just got two touching and agreeing and truly trying to reach heaven and giving God the glory, he will perform any miracle you need. That's what it's about. Touching and agreeing. A lot of us are missing out on our blessings because we're not touching and agreeing. We're not touching and agreeing. God said to me, a lot of blessings have been held up. As a matter of fact, someone sent me a text and they shared some things with me. And one of the things was, we have just like, you know, I was thinking about how some of the blessings that we've been waiting for and waiting for, what's taken so long. God said, I need everybody in this arena to come together in agreement. He said, because when you come together in agreement, I'm honored. I have to honor that because it's my word. I stepped outside of heaven to honor my word. And when you come together, touching and agreeing, and heart to heart, breast to breast, mind to mind, spirit to spirit, he said, I have to honor whatever you are agreeing about. Woo, he has to. He's an awesome God. Awesome, awesome. I started thinking, the word says, he's a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. He's a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. And a lot of times we get tangled up and bottled up and all mixed up with the wrong people. And the wrong people are sometimes sitting right next to us. And we don't understand that. Not that they're bad people, but they may not be going where you're going. So you need to understand those that labor among you. And in order to understand that, you got to have an ear to hear what thus saith the Lord, because you know that the enemy is running loose right now. He's running rampant because he know his time is winding up. That's why all the foolishness and craziness is going on. The Bible, the word of God, is fulfilling itself. The enemy is running afraid. He really is trying to grab any and everybody he can. And what he does is he can't make you do anything. Understand that. He can make you do anything. But what he will do is he will bring what they call foundational lies. Foundational lies. And those foundational lies start to get into your mind and your spirit. And you start to believe that stuff. And God said, you must have an ear to hear what I say and know the difference. What did he say? What did he say? My sheep. Come on, and a stranger. The devil is a stranger. He should be a stranger to you. He should be a stranger to you. He should not be able to distract you to the place where it brings disappointment to God. Amen. Romans 8, 38 and 39. You can turn there. I'm going to read this in the New Living Translation. I love the New Living Translation, but I love, like I said, my King James Version as well. It says, I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today nor our worries about tomorrow, not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. 39 says, no power in the sky above or in the earth below. Indeed, nothing in all creation, nothing will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. Now, remember, Christ Jesus is the one that stepped outside of heaven to honor his word. And you know why? Because God, the creator, he allowed us to know, I'm just spirit. So I'm going to send my son. And I'm going to let him come, not as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords that he is, but I'm going to allow him to come the same way that each and every one of y'all came. So from birth to death, there is not one feeling, one thought that any of us could have that Jesus has not already felt. So when you start thinking about being all alone in a bad situation, Jesus already felt it. He already knows it. And all you got to do is surrender it to him. Doesn't mean it's going to go away right away. That's not what that means. It means he'll give you a peace, that peace that surpasses all understanding. There is nothing like the peace of God. Nothing. There's no money in the world that can give you God's peace. Because the storm is raging. But you got a peace, and everybody's like, why is she just sitting there? Why is he just sitting there? They ain't saying nothing. They still praising God. And I know everybody talking about him. This done happened to him. That done happened to him. But God said, now I'm going to allow my peace to saturate you. And when God's peace saturates you, nothing else can touch you. In the midst of the storm. And what it does is it helps sustain you while you're going through the storm. Oh, my goodness. Now I'm going to read this one in the King James Version. Romans 8 and 30. Probably 29 and 30. And the word of God says, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called, and whom he called, them he also justified. All right, we're going to stop right there. Sometimes we have to bring a message that's going to teach, preach, and uplift and encourage. We didn't have to shout. But I hope y'all understood the message and how much he loves you. And who's here is supposed to be here. And always remember, no matter what it looks like, he stepped outside of heaven to honor his word for you, mother, for you, for me, for pastor, for my husband. He stepped outside of heaven to honor his word. And when he did it, woo, when he did do that, he surrendered his glory to you and me. He surrendered his glory to you and me. Do not take advantage of his glory, but recognize it, honor it, and watch it. God bless you.
Church has become so commercial until we have gotten away from its true purpose. It has become such big business until we allow people to operate and function as long as they have something to bring to the table. People are now more concerned about recording and living in life of the rich and famous rather than knowing Jesus. For the true purpose of the church is soul business, not big business.